I can remember as a kid, and I was born in 1931, so that might give you an idea of my age. There was such excitement as a child. My first memory is that my mother said, "Oh, we're going to Whatipū," and Dad was a mad shark catcher fisherman, and he'd go to the stream on the farm and he'd actually get an eel or two that would be put in a kerosene tin. And my mother said, "I've got to teach you to fish, boy." You know, I was called boy. And this is about the age of three or four. So she took me down to the little stream, just runs along the edge here, which they call the Gibbons' stream. And we fished for tomicots with a bent pin. I always remember that, and a worm. So that was my first introduction to fishing. And of course, as the years went on, and my dad became more and more engrossed in fishing and shark fishing, and then I learned all the other gambits of fishing. And of course, my mother, who was born here, it was just very emotional for her coming back after all those years each time. So we're just entering the old lodge, and in previous years, and like from 1870 onwards, this room actually, I think, was the kitchen. And that fireplace was quite important to the running of the kitchen, of course, in those days. In the 30s and 40s, when I came down, that fireplace used to be going, because invariably we'd have, because my dad was farming, we'd have our holidays here in the May holidays, which were quite cool. The lodge in those days was run by the Farleys. It was really a white tablecloth affair. You'd get sort of dressed up a little bit for dinner, which was lovely, and you'd be served at the table by the Farley girls in exactly the same way as my mother and her two sisters used to serve at the tables in their time down here. And one of the joys was actually having a cup of tea in bed in the morning, brought in by one of the girls, the Farley girls. They were happy times. My mother was Laura Gibbons. Her great-grandfather, John Gibbons, was the original Gibbons to come to New Zealand. John emigrated from Newfoundland and bought a land purchase in 1854 for the right to mill, opening the mills in Hooia. His son, Laura's grandfather, Nicholas Gibbons, went on to build the Whatipū Mill and Dam and the mill manager's house, which later became the Whatipū Lodge. The mills had been sold by the time Laura's father, Fred, took over, but he ran the lodge, and that's where my mum grew up. And she was schooled here, and then she was courted by my father in the 1920s. And of course, that's where the romance was, because Dad, at the end of the piha milling, was managing Dr. Rayner's farm. Rayner had owned the milling rights for that piha area. So Dad's first job was managing his farm, and he would ride by horseback all the way from piha down to Whatipū to court my mum. They went fishing and probably eeling. And I think my mother had a 410 shotgun. She was the most gentle person, but apparently she was a very good shot. You know, that's what they did as a sort of courting activity. The bridge here has come about since the 1930s, 40s. As a child, we would come down to about here, and the stream was actually almost level with the sand. It was all black sand, there was no growth. So people would go across the stream, which was very, just not terribly deep at all, and we'd walk across a 12 by 2 plank bridge. Whatipū, of course, was much more distant to Auckland than it is now, because we've got a roadway in, but in the early days there was only a cattle track, so everything had to come in by boat. It was the days in which the Manukau Harbour was really the highway for getting round all the edges of the harbour. This is the remnants of the tram line, really, that stretched all the way across the sands, around the west coast, past the caves to piha, for that milling in the 1910 to 21 period. And of course, on my right here is the remnants of the wharf. The wharf was an area of great activity. It was the only way of getting into Whatipū. And there was a regular transport service by various entrepreneurial boats. So they were not timber boats, they were actually carrying people and supplies to the various settlements around the harbour itself. In my day, in the 30s, Dad and I would be fishing off the wharf down there, but now all the timber is gone and you can just see the rock shelf. The dancing in the Whatipū Cave began probably the 1880s, after the milling had begun in the 70s. Later, in the 1920s, early 20s, I understand that my dad played the accordion in the cave. The cave was all dressed up with ferns and related, and there were candles around the sides of the cave and lamps. And people on a Saturday afternoon would come down on the tea tower or another similar vessel and land at the wharf here, and they would then walk across the sands to the Whatipū Lodge, and then the dancing would start probably about 8 o'clock. And I think they would dance till about 1 or 2 in the morning, until they were exhausted possibly. Then those folk would get up in the morning, the Gibbonses would give them a meal, they'd walk down and catch the tea tower again and go back to Onehunga on the Sunday morning. In the 1930s and 40s, well, as a child, when I used to come down with my mother and father and my elder sister Ailsa, we used to slide down the sand hill. This was all sand, and it's the reclaiming of it with all the biota is absolutely phenomenal. It's just lovely. Friends of Whatipū, Graham Murdoch asked me to start this some time ago, and he said, Bruce, would you be able to gather together a few people and act in a sort of governing way and help with the ecology and the sort of overview of what we're doing at Whatipū? Well, from that has developed Friends of Whatipū, which we've now got about 70 to 80 members. We'd spend a lot of our courting period at Whatipū. And Trixie fell in love with Whatipū. She just thought it was such a beautiful place. Of course, I just loved it. And I just wanted to write about the history of it. Friends of Whatipū have planted 10,000 trees, actually, roughly, in concert with the Auckland Regional Council originally, and now the Auckland Council. And the Arataki Nursery actually supplies the plants that we plant here now. So our most recent planting was be what we call Trixie's Knoll or Trixie's Hill. Initially the rangers put a seat up there in memory of Trixie, my wife, and that's just lovely. It's a lovely view out there. And we're calling it Trixie's Seat. And around the seat, we've done two plantings now. The first one was moderately successful, but we did another planting just a month or two back, and they're looking very viable, looking good apparently. So we're very pleased about that. Look at the planting coming through that we've done here. It's looking lovely, isn't it? The cabbage trees and putakawa, all sorts of lovely items that have been planted.
So Dad, his first job, his father said, what do you want to do?